Kick the Puppy or Kick the Kitten. That was okay, yeah. that was the actual name of our first episode, where we talked about morality in games.
I'm
pleading the fifth.
Yes.
This week on Backward Compatible, in our 50th episode, Richard Wirth joins Jim, Doc, and Chris to discuss interactive fiction and its relationship to games. Plus, a back and forth on Life is Strange and impressions of Minecraft Story Mode. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode number 50 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey, 50th episode, here we go.
And I'm joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And we have a very special guest calling in via Google Hangout from Pennsylvania. It is good old Richard Wirth.
Oh, I'm not that special.
It's Richard.
Richard is...
Well, I don't know. Some days I'm pretty special.
We figured it would be worth it.
Bring Richard
in.
Really?
I haven't heard that one in precisely 4.5 months. Thanks, guys.
Are you sure you don't want to go to the gym instead? Oh, jeez.
Yeah, I'm going to have to dock you for that one.
Yeah, I figured. Well,
let's not crisscross topics too much here, guys. Sorry.
Wow.
That was my own name.
Full square.
But anyway, we are doing our 50th episode. The meaty topic is going to be on interactive fiction, which would be lots of fun to talk about. But I might as well go and get started with our button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
I don't know what y'all have been playing. Doc, what have you been playing this?
Absolutely nothing.
Absolutely nothing.
That's not true.
According to what I wrote down here, you've been playing something.
No, it's absolutely true.
Adam, you lying scum.
I tell you what I haven't been playing. What I haven't been playing is Minecraft. Because what I have been playing is Minecraft Story Mode, which is really just Telltale's Tales of Minecraft, which I think is a much better title, personally. But... yeah, I was actually kind of disappointed in it, unfortunately.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm a great big fan.
I really didn't see that one living up.
You know, here's the thing. If you take a bunch of note cards and you write down all the things that are, like, popular with Minecraft, like, there's pigs. And, oh, you know what? You fall into water, you don't die. Oh, and you know what? You can build, like, big bridges across chasms. And, fighting zombies.
By the way, just... if I could interject in this this mosh segment, as someone who really hasn't played more than a few minutes
of
Minecraft, if someone has only played maybe a few minutes of Minecraft, you would describe those as the like selling points of Minecraft, and I hear that, and I'm just so confused.
Yeah,
but well, go ahead. Sorry.
Apparently, there's also mining and crafting, but you know, I mean, I played for years and I never come across.
Don't you open up by punching trees?
Yes.
See,
that's in there too.
That's what I remember is punching trees. Yeah.
Well, so let me put it this way. Okay, you've got all the aspects of Minecraft with a story, except instead of actually building a thing, you hit X a bunch of times to build the thing. And in,
oh man,
I know
the infamous hit X to do something.
Yeah. And
but,
so basically,
but is there story? Is there like story?
Oh yeah, there's a hard story in it, and you've got four main characters, and there's an old legend, and blah blah blah.
How gritty and hardcore is it?
And I'm just like,
do the trees have backstories? And if you hit X, you kill the trees, but you use them to build your like home or something.
No,
is there an objectivist narrative to this game? Yeah,
there's a very strong narrative, and it's that there is a competition that you want to try to win. Mm. And the only choice that I got to, and the part that I played was: are your friends going to stay behind and protect the thing that you've made, or are they going to come with you and try to save your pet pig? Yes, you have a pet pig. At which point, then they come with you. They come with you, and they disappeared from the screen and weren't actually there. So. I don't know. The whole thing just seemed really contrived and stupid.
Did they ever help you at all when you chose that they come with
you? Not in that point, no.
Contrived and stupid? You mean 90% of game narratives?
Well, here's the problem. You've got... very nice.
He means 95%, thank you, Richard.
You've got a game that is all about authentic player experience, and now you're trying to shoehorn in a story in a game that doesn't require one. Mm. And when you... are forced to deal with the elements that exist within the context of that, let's call it a world, there's only so many things that you can pull from. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not like Tales of the Borderlands where you can kind of open it up and bring in new stuff. You really can't. You're married to the rigidity of the items that exist within that game. I tell you, I practically got through the demo and was like, I've seen it all, I'm done. I don't know how they're going to do four more episodes.
Is this the second Telltale game series in which they've based it off of a video game? Because the first was Borderlands, right? Or is that not true?
That's a good question. I know they've done a lot of adaptations, but from video games, you might be right.
They've done mostly adaptations of comic books.
Well, they did the Tales of Monkey Island.
That's true. Tales of Monkey Island was the first one.
That's true, but was that really an adaptation?
Kind of different
format. Yeah, that was more of a continuation.
It was more of just an intellectual property sort of
thing. Right, that was more of a, because that was already an adventure series.
It's more of a game.
So that was more of a continuation of it. And then, you know, Back to the Future was an adaptation of a film, and then you've got Jurassic Park was a film adaptation. Yeah. The Walking Dead and
Poker Night at the Inventory, but that was not really.
That was poker.
Was it Walking Dead? The Wolf Among Us.
Wolf Among Us,
book. Both of those were comic book adaptation, or like related to comic books.
But so like there's definitely an interesting thing that happens when you're not translating a property to a new medium. Mm-hmm. You're translating a medium to a new form of that medium.
Yeah, right.
That's a good point.
Yeah, Telltale already has laundry list of design issues that occur in these episodic games, and to take a purely ludic experience like Minecraft and just try and slap a narrative on it. Which, I mean, let's all agree, right, that they did this to try and seize on the millions of, you know, preteen YouTube subscribers to Minecraft channels.
Oh, yeah. Certainly.
And, you know, to be fair, too, it's like, if there was anyone I think could pull it off, it would be Telltale. Yeah. But maybe they didn't.
If they had just like embraced that and gone with Yogscast to the video game, I think it would have been great. And actually, you know, gotten named YouTubers to actually voice the characters. That would have made sense to me. But they didn't. And so you're supposed to love these characters that are really just kind of wooden archetypes. And no, they're empty. You can insert yourself. No.
Well, I will say this. I'm still waiting for the Telltale adaptation of Dwarf Fortress and Tetris. I'm sure those are coming. So they have to adapt everything.
Press X to rotate.
Okay, so we're going to move along in this mosh to Chris. What have you been playing this week?
So I just finished up the finale of Life is Strange, which, speaking of Telltale, it's very early on it was compared a lot to Telltale style games because it's kind of got that more or less linear seeming narrative. And the thing
the
that makes
bottlenecking
it
style of narrative.
Yeah, exactly. But what it has that's interesting, the sort of selling point is that your protagonist is, I think, I'm not sure if it's technically high school or early college, either way, but you've got this girl who figures out she's able to rewind time a little bit.
She's a senior in high school, Chris. Duh.
Senior in high school, is that what it is?
Oh, yeah. Like Riley Rewind.
Blackwell Academy.
Everyone's seen.
You see, I just wasn't sure because they sort of like, I don't know. Anyway.
Did you not read her journal?
No, I did not read her journal.
That would be an invasion of privacy, Richard.
Exactly. No, but it makes for some interesting puzzle-solving mechanics. You know, there are a few times when a thing happens and you have to rewind time, but now you've got a thing or you're in a certain place and so now you can do something that you couldn't access before.
That's a lot of things.
Yeah, lots of things. And there's a theme that plays very heavily, especially as you get to the end, of the butterfly effect. And the more you try to change and the more you try to fix things, the more crazy other stuff gets. There's always going to be some sort of consequence.
Ultimately, is it a linear story, though?
You see, that I don't know, because I've only played through once. I imagine it basically is. There might be a few details that change, a la Telltale, but for the most part.
Well, so the same thing, like, with the Telltale games, we all know that they're bottlenecked narratives.
Yeah, oh, yeah,
but
big time.
But the first season of the Walking Dead episodic games, before we heard what everybody else did and we saw the flow chart of the narrative points and all that, it felt like it was sort of an open, malleable narrative. Even though it really wasn't, they had constructed that sort of illusion of choice really well.
Especially and Wolf Among Us, I think, did that even better.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man, that was amazing.
And that's actually... But, so like, sorry, go ahead.
Well, so, like, with Life is Strange, you know, you mentioned this great mechanic, but I think they have sort of an opposite issue that Telltale does, and that Telltale, they craft these really fantastic narratives for things like The Wolf Among Us and The Walking Dead, but mechanically the games fall really flat. Mm-hmm. Whereas I've played the first two episodes of The Life is Strange before my game bugged out on me. And the mechanics are really cool. You mentioned puzzle solving.
Yeah.
Like, the way that they execute that is really, really cool. But the narrative is so constrictive and linear and flat.
And I think that it does get better with time. The characters that start off feeling very flat and very, like, just, you know, here is generic high school character X, you know, they get fleshed out a little bit more as you go along. So
well, but I'm not just talking about character development. I'm talking about how... So, all right, do we mind if I... you know, quote unquote, spoil the first 10 minutes of episode one.
No, through the first couple episodes, it's
fine. Go ahead.
Okay, so, you know, you start the game off and you're in a high school after this dream, and you basically walk down a hallway, you hit X in front of a bunch of random NPCs to hear a one-off line, you know, inside the girl's sort of inner monologue. And then you're presented with a puzzle where you have to use your newly discovered time-rewinding powers to prevent a girl from getting shot in the bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, sort of painstakingly went through the entire high school, hit X in front of everybody just to sort of feel immersed in this environment, but there was no payoff for it at all.
Mm-hmm.
And this sort of continues through the first episode and into the second, as far as I've gotten, is that it's not about character development, because all of that sort of ambient narrative is there. It's that you have no sort of mechanical interaction with the environment. It's just a way to sort of propagate yourself through this one-off narrative.
That's a fair point, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think that as you play through the game more and more, you sort of find that in a way that stays the same. Without spoiling all too much, there are definitely parts of the narrative where there's definitely this commentary of, no matter what I do, it doesn't really matter. And the fifth episode is called Polarized, and it was a very polarizing episode, so that might give you a few hints as to the nature of the ending. Personally, I thought it was good. There are some very heavy themes and some really touching moments, actually, I thought, especially once you get to episode three and beyond.
Naturally, it's always the one right after the one you haven't played
yet. Of course, yeah. But I thought it was well done overall. I definitely think it's worth playing, and even though the time travel mechanic doesn't, you know, changed the world for me, it definitely does some interesting things. And
well, so then, in your opinion, does this get better? So in the first couple episodes, you know, and there's something to be said about being a tutorial for the player, but every single opportunity that you had to use your time rewinding power, it was either to do something extremely minimal, like warn somebody that an errant football is going to fly past their head, or you say the wrong thing, or you don't know the name of a thing, and you mess up a dialogue interaction because that's the way it was designed, and your character's like, oh, now that I know, I can rewind time and answer that, breaking the fourth wall.
Right.
You know?
A lot of that, and, basically, it stays the same mechanically, but it becomes more important. And in fact, actually, what's interesting, that errant football thing, that particular character, that sort of thing happens to her a lot. And I basically ignored her for most of the game, and that changes a little bit.
So, guys, I haven't played this game at all, but is there a reason why it's your choices, the way when you can rewind time is only for those particular instances?
It's just a design limitation, I feel.
So it's not really a narrative thing, really? I mean, not really.
Yeah, no, it's almost inconsequential every time. You know, maybe it gets better in the last three episodes. Maybe there's some sort of payoff. But so, for example, in the first episode, you walk up to a girl in the hallway and you don't know her name because you, the player, don't have that information. And so you sort of just take a guess. And if you get it right, cool. If you don't get it right, she tells you her name, you rewind it 15 seconds and give it the right answer.
Yeah.
But there's no real payoff for that. There's no, like, all right, now there's this sort of open, interactive student party later on, and you can sort of interact with the people that you've made positive impressions with and things like that. It's all very shallow.
Some things that seem shallow do end up being fairly consequential. It's not like every single thing you do has a big consequence, but sometimes it is fairly important that you do make those impressions on people. And one other thing I'll mention on this real quick before we move on is that one of the things you can do actually with the rewind is you make a big decision in the game, kind of like those big, like, do you do A or do you do B moments that you have in Telltale. And you can see what happens, and you can actually choose to rewind and do the other choice if you sort of have second thoughts.
I can do that too. It's called saving. They
build it into the game.
Oh, okay.
But
so what's interesting about it is not built in.
Psychologically, though, that makes you think about all the decisions you're making and the fact that you could have changed something.
Really?
And then much later in the game, when something happens based on one of those decisions, but you can't rewind back that far, it's kind of like, oh, maybe I should have changed that. It really makes you think twice, or it's an extra psychological thing that happens when built into the game is this ability to undo.
I will say that it's probably good to preface that by saying it made you think that way, as opposed to projecting it to everyone else. But I do understand what you're saying, think that's interesting.
Yeah, and I'll sort of also add a little closing remark that even if things do sort of pay off in the end, oh, I can't rewind that far, is it really worth taking two episodes, two 3 hour long experiences to get to that point?
Yeah.
You know?
Fair enough, yeah. I thought it was worth playing through, but yeah, I can definitely see how one, two episodes through it. The end of episode two is fairly big. I don't know if you finished episode two, Richard.
Unfortunately, I didn't. My PS3 version is glitched.
The end of episode two is what kind of hooked a lot of people, from what I understand.
Oh,
so,
interesting. Oh, great, man! It's always, well, if it takes always
you,
like this.
If it takes you, I don't know. Okay, let's not
two episodes.
Yeah, let's not even get into that. But for me, in my opinion, if a game takes you that long to hook you, that's it's already failed. Yeah. But,
in that spirit, though, yeah. there was one moment in story mode, in Minecraft story mode, mm-hmm. that I thought was actually quite hilarious. And it was, you know how whenever you make these decisions, it always pops up. It's kind of the Telltale's classic thing of so-and-so will remember that.
Yeah.
There's this thing of, let's come up with a secret handshake. And so you get to choose which secret handshake you're going to do. And it's called like the Builder's Bump is the one I chose. Mm-hmm. And so they did this really stupid thing. And then it popped up and it said, no one will remember that.
That's funny.
That's great.
I liked it.
That's great.
Meta humor.
In Tales from the Borderlands, if you skip the credits, it will say the developers will remember that.
Oh.
And then if you do it repeatedly, it will say, we're starting to take this personally.
Mm. All right. Funny. So that I guess we'll go ahead and move on from our extended Mosh section.
Mosh.
I know I've really just been replaying stuff, and I don't know, Richard, is there something you want to talk about real quick? Or should we go ahead and move on?
No, not particularly. Though on sort of the same note of taking a while to hook you, I have been going back to old MMOs that I've been playing, and so I jumped back into Star Wars The Old Republic.
Yeah,
and,
actually, I did that too.
I remember when we all first started playing it like 3-4 years ago, the game had the sort of the typical MMO issue of running out of content, and so there's nothing to really keep you playing. And so now coming back to it after giving them 3 years to come up with stuff, it's been pretty cool. I like it.
Have they done a lot with those 3 years?
Yeah, so the second expansion that they released was kind of a flop. People were really upset, but the most recent one, I haven't gotten all the way there yet in terms of leveling my character, but apparently they've sort of given up on the MMO design space and have sort of just made it a BioWare interactive narrative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they took a lot of cues from Knights of the Old Republic. So what's this one? Knights of the Fallen Empire, I think?
Knights of the Fallen Empire, which, speaking of KOTOR, they have completely ported KOTOR 1 to the phone.
I have
really?
The entire Knights of the Old Republic on my Android phone.
I love
all of the mechanics are the same.
That's a great, I mean, I love Knights of the Old Republic. I love Knights of the Old Republic 2. I think they were both excellent, excellent games.
Yep.
Okay, cool. Yeah, actually, I might end up checking that out. I mean, if they really have made it more like Knights of the Old Republic, then it might be worth looking at, especially since apparently it is free now.
It is, yeah. Though to get the expansion content, you do have to be a subscriber. But if you subscribe and then unsubscribe, you do keep all of that content. Mm-hmm. So it's $15 for everything.
Oh, okay.
Way to hack it.
Well, speaking of dick moves, our next segment, we're going to update. Richard is going to give us an update on what he's been doing in Pennsylvania in a new and unique segment that Nick will probably spend, you know, at least an hour or two coming up with music just for this one segment that will never be played again.
Well, it might.
And whenever we'll call this segment,
whenever we talk to Richard.
And we're calling this segment Dick Move. Richard, would you like to give us an update on what you've been doing?
You know, it's It's been about four or five months since I left Texas, and in that entire time, nobody has made a dick joke about my name, and nobody has made a Wirth joke about my last name.
And you feel horrible. You feel like you've missed out.
Oh, yeah, I'm just so alienated. I just, nobody realizes the full potential of my name.
For the record, we tossed this name out as a joke in pre-planning, and now apparently it's a thing.
So no, you really thought I was going to not include this? How long have you known me? Are you
name jokes, I tell ya.
But Richard, no, I think it's really cool. I know that you're over in, you have a full, it's a full fellowship, right? Is that what it's called? You're a fellow?
Yeah. So in PhD programs, you usually are either an RA, a research assistant, or a teaching assistant to sort of have them pay for all your schooling. I was given a distinguished graduate fellowship, which basically means that I'm free for the first year. I'm a free agent, not tied to anybody, and they sort of pay my way and just tell me to go do stuff.
Awesome.
Cool. So specifically, I mean, are you currently engaged in some sort of in like a specific field of study, or are you just still kind of getting your feet wet in university and getting used to, you know, the new surroundings and teaching classes, that kind of thing?
Oh no, I'm pretty mired in research. So I've been doing very little in terms of sort of direct game studies, though. Actually, just last week, some of my work about trusting other players in virtual environments was presented at the Association of Internet Researchers. One of the professors at UT Dallas presented in my stead, since I couldn't travel down there.
And nice. I assume that you, the findings of your research wasn't just don't. It's a little more involved.
No, it was sort of based around the question of what does the role of social structures have on whether people trust one another, and is that trust enacted in sort of a ludic sense? So I studied whether people in guilds or people without guild tags elicited more or less trust, more frequent instances of self-disclosure where you sort of talk about yourself, and then also ask players if they were more likely to sort of attack or mistreat players that did not have a guild tag.
I think you might have talked about some on the podcast at one point, actually.
That's actually really cool.
Probably.
So, so what games did you specifically focus on in your research?
Was it World of Warcraft? So for most players, I asked them about World of Warcraft, since that was the more common one. But I also did a case study inside of Archage, which is a game that I have talked about here on the podcast before. But so as a brief recap, it's a Korean MMO that was ported over to the US about a year ago. And it's got a lot of Eve design elements, the physical transportation of goods, that sort of economic point. And players can just attack anybody at any time. You can flag up and kill your own faction. If you commit a bunch of crimes, there's an in-game punitive system. You go to court and other players are selected to be on your jury. If you commit too many crimes, you get kicked out of your faction and every NPC in the game is hostile to you. You know. So it's basically this sort of social structure of the game, and it was the basis for my thesis, which was a study of feudalistic culture inside of the game. But so beyond that, I haven't really done much work in games directly, though I have sort of carried on that research about empathy and emotions, things like that. My most recent sort of research proposals have had to do with sentiment analysis, which is this sort of machine learning method for analyzing emotion and sentiment in online textual communication. So applying that to see if you can use automated natural language processing methods to detect emotion.
Now, I bet on the internet it's probably going to be very heavily slanted toward rage. Just the machine must be busted.
Off.
Everything comes up rage.
Part of that too on the internet, it's like it's very easy to come across that way. But you can't really say just because someone comes across as though they're angry in text that they're actually angry. So it's a very interesting distinction there too. Just because someone is like typing in all caps, using exclamation points, that doesn't mean
that's
they're
the
angry.
Thing is that sentiment analysis is at a point where it's very limited in what it can do in terms of the nuance of language, but it does sort of focus on the syntactical construction of language rather than just, you know, our interpretation of, oh, that guy's talking in all caps, he must be really mad. So
it's kind of like what Watson does, right?
Yeah, essentially, yeah. Well, so it's the same sort of basis of natural language processing, except this one, what I'm doing, is very, very simple. It sort of assesses for the polarity of sentiment. It looks at positive or negative, a binary value.
Okay.
And there's this body of research that says that people that over time express more positive and happy sentiment are more likely to be emotionally intelligent.
Huh. So let me ask you this then. How would you characterize sarcasm? Is that considered positive or negative?
Sarcasm is a bit too nuanced for natural language processing, but I would probably characterize that as usually hostile.
Okay.
But
that's 90% of my communication right there. So,
in terms of sort of the psychological literature, there's over 200 different classified emotions, and so sarcasm in there would probably fall under sort of the hostile, angry, negative connotation, but probably somewhere closer to the middle.
Okay. All right, that's not too bad. Closer to the middle. I'll take it. I'll take it.
It's time for Game Show, where the Backward Compatible crew play a game show kind of game on their gaming show. What sort of crazy game show challenges in store this week on Game Show? Let's find out right now on Game Show.
I'm going to ask y'all questions, or actually give you answers, based on things that you said in episode one of the podcast. I'm going to see just how well y'all remember, and how well you can guess, potentially, who might have said this.
Okay.
I did actually ask, since Doc wasn't on episode one, I asked him these questions earlier today. So he'll have a little leg up in the sense that he might remember his own answers, but that's it. So these three questions are all questions that y'all have answered before.
Jim.
No, it's not an answer. That y'all have answered before on episode one of the podcast, which was called, what was it, Kick the Puppy? Kill the Puppy, I think it was.
Kick the Puppy or Kick the Kitten.
What?
Kick the Puppy or Kick the Kitten, that was it. That was the actual name of our first episode, where we talked about morality in games.
I'm pleading the fifth.
Yes.
You're given a false choice.
A false choice, yes.
Okay, you have a choice here. Will you kick the puppy or kick the kitten? Well, I don't want to kick anything.
Yes. In fact, Richard, your answer in particular was, I don't want to kick anything. So that was one of the things that you said.
We were talking about BioShock.
But it wasn't an option.
Yes, we were talking about a lot of different games in that episode. It was pretty interesting to go back and listen to it again, which I did earlier today. It was actually a pretty enjoyable episode, so I do recommend if anyone wants to go back and listen to it. It's very freewheeling, but it's worth listening to.
That's still one of those games that people constantly ask me why I hate so much.
which game?
BioShock Infinite.
Oh, BioShock Infinite. I don't like that game either. Yeah, it was. I like BioShock.
That was
I did not like Infinite.
That was an interactive story.
it was both. I would hesitate to say either was good.
We'll get to that in a minute.
We'll get to that in a minute. That's actually good. Interactive story, interactive fiction are related. You think they're the same thing, but they're not. Okay, so
I think Richard said that.
So, Richard, I'm going to ask you this question first. And just so you know, the answer is only going to be Chris, Doc, myself, or you. Your answer will be mixed in here. But don't give it away if you recognize your own answer. So, whose most frustrating gaming experience was finding the three shards of the Chaos Emerald?
So is this the point that I answer?
This is the point that you answer.
How's
that would be Chris, our resident Santa.
That would
fan.
Be Chris.
How's that
Richard?
Frustrating?
Richard? 5 points.
It was specifically in the context
already
of Sonic
winning.
Adventure 2.
Oh, was it hard to do?
Yeah, we're gonna move on.
It was
yes.
a Knuckles level.
Oh, yes, okay. yes. This will be fun though. We'll see if we can remember. I think a lot of these are pretty telling for who we are. Okay, so Richard, you have 5 points. So the way the game is going to work is that I can ask you another question, and you can try to get some more points. However, every time you get a question wrong, somebody else can potentially steal that question for double points. So I can ask you another question. You can try for 5 more points, or you can pass to Doc, and Doc can answer the question.
Try for more points.
You want to try for more points? Okay, you're going to try. So Richard is going to try for more points.
It's going to turn into Richard just like winning the game.
I was going to say.
Okay.
No,
Richard, what did I say was my favorite Nintendo 64 game?
I don't know. That's a big blank.
Can you guess? You have a guess? You might get it right.
I'm just going to go ahead and say Zelda, Ocarina of Time.
That is incorrect. Doc, you have a chance to steal.
Majora's Mask.
Also incorrect. So no one gets this answer right. It'll be still on the board for later.
Chris wants to answer.
But now, Chris, it is now your turn.
Okay.
Okay, so now Chris has control of the board.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to go back to the first question. So, Chris, whose most frustrating gaming experience was the autosave feature being too active or being not active enough?
I would say that'd be Richard.
You're correct.
Yeah.
5 points. Richard, do you remember saying that?
I do.
What game was that for?
It was for actually JR. Well, I'll ask you. Do you remember what?
It was Final Fantasy VII, right?
Yeah. So not being active enough was my problem with the earlier Final Fantasy games, mm-hmm. because, man, that older technology, I played on the portable PlayStation with the monitor that you could attach on the back, and playing like an entire disc of the game and then not saving and like the power flickering or the disc scratching or stalling. Oh, that was the most disheartening. Actually, one of our friends, Michael Sewell, he still has not played all the way through Final Fantasy VIII or IX because his game has done that to him 3 or 4 times.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. Speaking of Sewell, shout out to you. Battleborn looks awesome.
Yes, it does, actually. Okay, so, Chris, you are still in control. All
right.
So I'm going to ask you another question. Would you like to pass and have the first chance to steal?
I'll try passing it to Richard. Why not?
All right, we're passing it over to Richard. Richard?
Oh, man, this is sweet.
Okay. Richard.
Jim.
Whose greatest gaming accomplishment was going 100% on Grand Theft Auto Vice City?
That'd be you.
Who is you? Because we're on a podcast. No one can
see. Oh, Jim.
That is incorrect.
Really?
That is incorrect. Chris.
I'm going to say Doc.
Chris, you are correct. That is 10 points.
Yes.
Wait, but Doc wasn't in our first episode.
I know. I told you. I asked him questions earlier today.
Oh.
I asked him questions earlier today. That is the valid answers are any of us at the table.
I remember what your favorite gaming accomplishment was.
If you remember, you probably shouldn't say it because that question could come back around again.
Yeah, no, I'm not going to. Okay. But yeah. Oh, man. I got tripped up.
Yeah, it happens. That's part of the game. Okay, so, Chris, you are back in control.
When do I get control?
Actually, since he just stole one, I think it actually should go back around again. So, yeah, so Doc, all right, so now...
Now wouldn't it be Richard, though? Or was the steal, I passed my turn, and...
You passed your turn, Richard had his turn, and he failed.
And we're going counterclockwise.
Yeah, we've been going this way, actually, is how you've been doing it. So that's
true. Well, I haven't answered anything, so it can't be true.
Jim is currently...
I've asked
gesturing.
You a question, you've just gotten it correct.
What? Mm-hmm. Really?
Yes. Okay, Doc.
You tried to steal the N64 question.
Mm-hmm. You got it wrong.
Oh. I didn't know that trying to steal counted as my turn.
Mm-hmm. Everything counts. Everything counts. This is a very carefully constructed game.
Yes. Yeah.
What's the Drew Carey quote from Whose Line Is It Anyway? Where the questions are made up and the points don't matter?
Yeah, right. that's pretty much what we're doing here. Okay, so...
We're game designers.
I prefer the Colin Mockery version.
Okay, Doc, what did Chris say was his favorite Nintendo 64 game?
This game is fixed. since I was specifically instructed not to listen to the first podcast.
Oh, right, yeah, exactly, exactly.
His favorite Nintendo 64 game.
That he's, now, let me preface this. This is what he said was his favorite in episode 1.
Uh-huh.
So Chris, maybe he changed his mind later, but in episode 1, this was the game he said was his favorite.
I'm going to go with Sonic the...
Well, N64 game.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
That's
a good point. Sonic wouldn't be on Nintendo.
Okay.
Not then.
I probably should have just counted that and moved on.
No, let's go with Mario 64.
That is incorrect.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, I cannot let you steal, unfortunately, because
that's fine.
This is your answer.
Yeah.
So, Richard, I will give you a chance to steal.
Oh, jeez.
We know it can't be Sonic because this is Nintendo. That narrows it down for me.
I'm gonna go with Mario Kart. What was the Mario Kart on N64?
Mario Kart 64.
Mario Kart 64.
Yeah, that one.
Mario Cartridge.
Incorrect. We're back around to Doc. Okay, so who said their greatest gaming accomplishment was taking down the Lich King on hard mode in World of Warcraft?
Oh, that totally had to be Richard.
It was Richard.
Yeah. There's no doubt.
Yep.
Richard, do you remember saying that?
Oh, yeah,
you,
for sure.
You said you specified, which I didn't mention, but you specified it was 25-man raid mode.
Dude, you took that to Lich King?
No, yeah, that was, I remember that. That was, that's, I think that still is what I would answer, because that was back with the people, the guild that I raided with for years and years, and, you know, we were really proud that we had, like, a three-day-a-week raid schedule, which, now that I'm a grown-up, sounds like a hell of a lot.
Yeah.
But, like, most hardcore raiding guilds get raided, like, 5 to 6 days a week, and we still got, like, the number, I think it was, like, 17th horde Heroic Lich King kill.
Nice.
So that was pretty awesome. I actually found my old photo bucket the other day, and I still had screenshots from that in there.
Nice. Nice. Photo bucket. I haven't seen that site in a while.
Okay, we're going to go around real quick. We're going to do a quick lightning round.
Lightning round.
So to solve this game out, and I'm going to start with Richard, and I'm going to name three games, and you're going to try to attach them to... since we've already answered for favorite N64 game, we've already attached... We already know what Chris's favorite game was, because I gave it away earlier. But we still haven't identified what you said your favorite game was, what
Got
my
it.
Favorite game was, and what Doc's favorite game was in N64. You're going to try to... You are going to try to associate each one. And I'm going to include yours in here, too, so you're going to have to try to remember what you said at the time. So...
I already know what mine is.
Okay. Okay. Well, maybe you do. We'll see. All right, so here are the three games. Super Smash Brothers, Diddy Kong Racing, Quake 2.
Yep, got it.
Associate them. Go.
Mine is Diddy Kong Racing. Yours is... I think yours is Super Smash, but maybe yours is Quake. So I'm going to go with Doc as Quake and yours is Super Smash.
That is correct.
It was Quake 2.
Cool. Quake 2, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That is correct. Okay, Chris?
Yes.
Same deal. So here we go. So currently, Chris is in the lead with 15 points. Richard has 10 points. Doc has 5 points.
Rub it in.
Chris.
Yes.
For 5 points, I'm going to ask you, this is their most frustrating gaming experience. Who claimed that this was their most frustrating gaming experience? Getting all of their games and consoles stolen.
That would be Doc.
That is correct. Doc, do you want to elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, you know, clearly I had too many games, and so a nice person from the neighborhood around Christmas time decided it would be, in the spirit of the holiday to kick in my door and steal all my stuff.
Mm. See, it's not so much him being taking, it's you giving. And that's in the spirit of Christmas.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, insert some jingle bells right here, because...
Okay, this is the final round in which anyone that gets this question correct will win the entire game, because that's just the way it works. It's worth 20
this is,
points.
This is very Game Grumps versus.
It's worth
sort
20
of.
Points.
Or 20,000.
I'm starting
points.
With Doc.
Oh,
20
excellent.
Points. If you get
redemption.
This right, it's over for redemption.
I got this.
What is my being Jim, what is my greatest gaming accomplishment? That I said was my greatest gaming accomplishment. I should preface that.
Yep,
and episode one of the podcast.
Dear.
If you get it wrong, it's going to go in the same circle that we have, which means it goes to Chris first and then Richard.
No, not Chris.
Do you know?
I am shooting
if
blind.
If you're close enough, I'll give you the right
answer. I am shooting blind from the hip here.
Okay.
But I'm going to go with beating the second level of Zelda, the original Zelda.
No.
When were you type in Link?
That is incorrect.
Oh. Okay.
Chris.
Beating the final dungeon in Zelda 2?
That is correct.
All right.
Beating
Zelda
2? Beating Dark Link in Zelda 2.
That's basically what
yeah.
I said, right?
No.
The second Zelda.
I remember
you said the
like,
second dungeon in the original.
You said
that,
yeah.
Did you were hanging out with your grandfather
yeah.
and like
yes.
he helped you
he
play.
You
I, meant the, I actually meant the second, the second map.
In Richard there. Remembered. Richard remembered the story, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Chris, you win the game.
Woo! With 20,020 points.
Yeah, Chris has, 40 points? Yeah, Chris has 40 points. So Chris, you did a really good job.
Thank you.
Richard has 10 points. Doc,
yeah,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, but you still like Sonic, so.
Yes, that's true.
Wait, you weren't going for golf score?
No. No golf score.
I played it wrong. Let's start over.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
I have a Mobile Minute on the Android version of King of Dragon Pass. This is a game that I played and I did a little bit of research on when I was in, you know, studying for my MFA. Essentially, this game is all about, you're in this sort of, like, Viking-esque Nordic world, and you build a clan and you manage it. It's a simulation game. And you sort of manage all of the resources. You have a council, which is sort of like a parliament or a congress type thing, when you have several council members, and they each have their own little advantages, disadvantages, their statistics, and they sort of advise you on all these different story choices that you get throughout the game. So various events happen within your town, and you have to choose, for example, like, say you stumble upon like a town of like these little like humanoid duck creatures, and you can either work with them and trade with them, or you can just send your army to destroy them and take all their resources. So you have all these different options. And sometimes you just have a few options, sometimes you have four options, sometimes it's, you know, a little more than that. And all your advisors, they each have different approaches. So, you know, the one that's more militaristic might say, yeah, let's just kill them and take everything. And the one that's like, you know, very friendly and hippie-esque will be like, no, let's just help them out and give them everything. Maybe they're starving. And you have the ones that are more balanced and kind of goes back and forth. It's very interesting. It actually ties into our discussion here in a few minutes of interactive fiction, because it sort of skirts that border. It's really a simulation game. Mm-hmm. But it does have elements of interactive fiction, because there are choose-your-own-adventure elements where you have all these interesting story choices that impact your clan and change the story of your clan. And the idea is that you're not really playing as one person. You're playing as this sort of like overseen leader of your clan, trying to essentially eventually become the king of Dragon Pass.
Wasn't there also a prologue segment where you get to sort of like say what your history was?
Yes,
and that affects your stats?
Yes, and there is a prologue segment, yes, where you get to basically determine, you know, who is your sort of like guiding deity. Mm-hmm. And it could be none if you wanted it to be. But you have all these different options of that sort of determine your starting status, where you might have initially settled, how many people you might initially have, what sort of resources they might have, what sort of deity are you on good terms with, which one are you not on good terms with. And so it's sort of it was a strong influence on one of my projects that I did for my MFA thesis project. But also, it's an interesting game. It's about $5. You can get it on Android platforms currently. They've done sort of an updated artwork, a few extra story events for Android. But it was originally on PC, released about, 12, 13 years ago. But it's called King of Dragon Pass, so I do recommend it. Okay, so we're going to move right along into our what we like to call our meaty topic. We're going to really delve deep into interactive fiction. So a couple of points we're going to discuss. We're going to talk about, hey, what is interactive fiction and how does it differentiate itself from other games? What are the strengths of and weaknesses of interactive fiction versus specifically prose, prose fiction, narrative? And what is this relationship to Choose Your Own Adventure, and how has it influenced current adventure games like The Wolf Among Us, Walking Dead, a lot of these Telltale games, something like Life is Strange? How has it influenced those? Because interactive fiction currently, I don't know if I wouldn't really call it a dead genre, because we've recently played some interactive fiction games on Android.
Oh, yeah.
Like
in fact, it's making a resurgence.
Right, like Lifeline, for example. So there's been some interesting interactive fiction games that have come out recently. And specifically, when I think of interactive fiction, and maybe this is just because of my background, I'm thinking of text adventure games like the old Zork games,
yeah,
for example. So that's what I really think of as interactive fiction.
Planetfall, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Yes, precisely. I don't really count adventure games, even though there's a strong narrative there, I don't really count those as interactive fiction. But there's
Would
certainly a relationship
game books
there.
Inside interactive fiction?
Which one?
Game books?
Define game books for us.
Actually, yes. If you're talking about the Lone Wolf games, for example.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah, so game books being sort of the either dice-driven, character-driven, you know, choose-your-own-adventure style games, or more modern, you know, on iOS and I think Android. There's quite a few of them in the App Store where basically, you know, it's like the Goosebumps, you know, choose-your-own-adventure novels, except you've also got sort of ludic elements of character stats, buying and selling items at certain points in the story, exploring different areas and getting objects that affect the outcome of the narrative, things like that.
You find yourself in yon dungeon, you see a flask. You cannot get e-flask.
That's no, those there's a close relationship there, and I think the big difference between a game book and a choose your own adventure in game books are also pretty close too. But I do think game book is a lot closer to interactive fiction. But what the one of the big differences is that when you're playing an interactive fiction game, normally they'll give you at most a paragraph of text before you have a choice. So there's a lot of choices. Whereas in a game book, sometimes it'll be a couple of pages before you get a choice. So there is that differentiation there. I don't know. I think it's probably on the cusp. For me, I'd probably go ahead and count it. But I could totally understand the argument for those who say it's not really the same thing.
Yeah, so I would count it strictly, you know, based on, you know... So I don't know how esoteric you guys want to go on the podcast, but you guys have all read Espen Arseth, right?
Not sure that I have.
Yes.
What? Yeah, so ergodic literature?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the notion of what he describes as being ergodic literature or ergodic text, or, you know, in our case, true interactive narrative, mm-hmm. It's whatever is more than the idle moving of the eyes and the turning of the pages. So choose your own adventure, you know, the interaction there is really just turning to different pages, you know, in a book sense, in the Goosebumps sense. So I wouldn't call that interactive fiction. But a game book, even though it's close to a choose your own adventure, it does have those sort of ludic elements that involve cognitive processes that are other than just reading and turning pages. So,
well, now I wonder though, if in the choose your own adventure, the turning of pages, you're selecting a specific page to turn to rather than just sort of flipping through one page at a time.
Of course, that is mechanically what it is, but mm-hmm. really, does that involve, you know, enough of a cognitive process to really be considered interactive?
I think it does, in the sense that you do have to consider a choice, and you make a choice, you know, more or less strategically.
But I mean, in those games, in Choose Your Own Adventure in particular, because I read a lot of those, especially when I was younger. I don't really read them anymore, but the sort of choices that you would make would be, it really would feel like it didn't really matter. Like, what seemed like a choice that made sense strategically, if you would flip to that page, something totally unexpected might happen. And the reverse is also true.
You're talking about actual choose your own adventure.
I'm talking
books?
About actual choose, not yeah. not game books. Actual
There's a
choose
simple
your
reason
adventure.
For that, and it's that choose your own adventure books were not consistent unto themselves. In other words,
right.
there's a Schrodinger's cat element to this. The witch could, if you turn to page 12, actually be a fair maiden in disguise.
Mm-hmm.
But if you turn to page 96, based on a different decision you've made, she's actually a horrible hag who'll throw you in
but,
an oven.
But also, there's no like foreshadowing of what is the correct answer either.
That's correct. Well, that's because there isn't a correct answer until you choose.
Right.
And that's...
Yeah, typically they're just gotcha situations.
Right.
Like the Goosebumps books,
yeah.
you know, you had no real educated guesses to make.
Right.
Which is why the Goosebumps reading strategy was to just read with all of your fingers between the pages holding
that's
your places.
Correct.
Yes.
If only they had had Post-its in mm-hmm. that day, right?
I think part of it was really more about the enjoyment of seeing what your choice, like the effects of your choice, as opposed to trying to plan out, you know, a strategy to make the right decision.
Yeah.
Whereas, and I think that's what makes interactive fiction sort of differentiates itself from choose your own adventure books, even though I do think there was an influence there. I do
yeah,
think there's an influence,
that's
true. But I think interactive fiction is they're trying to give you these, especially because they give you a lot more granular choices. It's, do you want to go, you know, left, right, forward, backward? Do you want to, you see like a mailbox over here. Do you want to open the mailbox? Do you want to look inside? Do you want to open what's in there? You have a little bit more, you have a lot of like little choices along the way. And because of that, because you only might read, usually it's only a few sentences. Sometimes it's a paragraph, but usually it's a small amount of text before you have a choice. It gives you all of these options, so it feels more like you're more involved in the story and you're sort of forming your
right.
own story.
So mm-hmm. rather than having binary win-loss conditions, you know, like you have in Choose Your Own Adventures, you typically navigate your way through a space. So that's the way mm-hmm. I look at both interactive fiction and game books is, you know, it's more about exploring a space in multiple dimensions rather than sort of a single forking path.
Now, have you, all three of us here at the table have played recently this mobile game called Lifeline. Have you heard of it or played it? Richard?
I have not.
Essentially, and this I would count as interactive fiction, although arguably it's a little closer to Choose Your Own Adventure. It's sort of like rides the line.
Wait. Lifeline, the game, is that the PlayStation 2 game?
No. It's only available on mobile from my
understanding. I know which one you're talking about, though. That was the voice-activated one. That was kind of interesting.
Yeah, yeah. No. I always go back to that example. It's an interactive fiction game where you use the PlayStation microphone to direct the character.
Oh, yeah.
This is just a weird coincidence that it has the same title.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But you are directing a character.
You are directing a character. Yeah. But there's some distinct differences that I would argue, Jim, make it not interactive fiction in the way that you mean it. The first is that it's got this really fantastic thing of being in real time.
Right.
Or near real time. So that whenever the main character, his name is Taylor.
Taylor.
As in Charlton Heston's character from.
Bright Eyes. Good old Bright Eyes from Planet of the Apes.
Planet of the Apes. It starts where he's crash landed on this weird moon and he's like, I'm a student and I don't know what to do. Help me because I can't make decisions on my own. But actually, he's kind of an endearing character, so I shouldn't say that. But the main differences are that thing where it's happening in real time, but also the world is persistent. It's the decisions that you make don't change the reality of the world. And I think that reflects more of a modern design aesthetic than the old Choose Your Own Adventure.
Yes, but I think for interactive fiction, though, like, for example, the old Zork games, I do think that, at least from what I remember, the world was consistent.
Yeah, but the problem is this.
But you had more choices, and that's the thing. There's a very big difference between Lifeline and Zork.
Lifeline is bottlenecked.
Right.
If I was going to draw out Lifeline and all the choices, I think it would honestly look more like the Telltale stuff that we were talking about earlier.
And I agree.
Than anything else. You've got 3 days, in from his perspective. Whether you choose to take longer than that is irrelevant, because he'll actually wait for you. It's like, I'm kind of hungry right now. Should I eat? And then he'll wait for 3 days for you to respond. if you ignore that, the fact that... there's three, call them boxes of cards, if you will, right? Note cards with the decisions on them. You pull out box one, and that's day one. And then you go through the cards in order, unless you say to him, no, skip over to another part. And then there's sort of these sections that are written, and you kind of have to go through all of the parts before you can move on to two. I actually played it through 3 times. Yeah.
And there's a lot of different endings.
There are different endings. But most
of them are...
You die prematurely.
Yeah, it's more like if... Like, there's one correct ending, arguably, and then there's...
There's two. I wanted to ask you guys, did you save the captain?
Yeah, I did. No.
Yeah. Did you know you could save the captain?
No. Yeah, I saved the captain.
I didn't know I could save the captain until the second time I played it, and that was just dumb luck. So there are some really interesting things kind of hidden in there, but as far as the main storyline goes, I would argue that we fundamentally had the same experience, the three of us. Whenever we played through it, because it's extremely linear and it bottlenecks really hard.
So, do you think then that really for a true interactive fiction experience, you need to have that freedom to explore the world at your own pace? And that's something that, for example, in the Zork games, you could do. You had that option of going in a whole bunch of different directions and explore the area. Whereas, for example, in Lifeline, it was much more of a linear experience.
And so here's where I think we need to start to demarcate what we're talking about, though.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we had a brief conversation before the podcast about what exactly is interactive fiction. And, you know, it's confusing to have interactive fiction as the name of a genre, because if you're talking about just the pure definition of interactive fiction.
It's fiction that's interactive.
Correct.
Right. Yes. But then so what levels of and so I would say that if you're not talking about that and you're talking about the genre, then you're talking about different levels and modes of interaction. So I haven't played this game in particular, but you know, it's the same thing it sounds like in terms of narrative interactivity as Life is Strange, where you're interacting in a surface level sense such that the specific delivery of the narrative might be changed or you feel involved in the narrative, but you're not actually interacting with the narrative structure.
That's
you're
a good
not
way of putting it, yeah.
changing fundamentally the paths that characters take, the destinations that they arrive at, things like that. So the different level of interactivity is really what differentiates genres for me.
I would agree.
I agree with that statement completely. And so I've sort of backed off of Lifeline from, because it really is more like a choose your own adventure style, very a linear experience in which you can experience large chunks of the story in a different order based on your choices, but you're still experiencing the same chunks. It's not quite the same as you might get from some of these early interactive adventures. There was another one, actually, because there's actually been several that have come out somewhat recently. There's one that's called, Cyberpunk 2044, something like that, which was an interesting interactive fiction. I played it about 2 or 3 years ago. I'm trying to remember specifically what it was called, but I'll have to look it up later.
Cyberpunk 2077.
Is that correct? Is that it?
Yeah.
Did you play that one too?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, so that, I mean, but you would consider that interactive fiction as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that. Yeah. So this is also a game made by CD Projekt Red, the same people who made mm-hmm. The Witcher.
Mm-hmm.
And that game and The Witcher, and just in case people haven't played Cyberpunk, you know, it has.
I didn't realize it was a out. Different. I need to play it.
Yeah, and so this game also has a different sort of mode of interaction in that you don't change the final destination. You know, the main narrative thrust is going to be the same. However, the way that you interact with characters and side quests and subplots fundamentally and persistently changes the world that you're occupying such that the final destination of the narrative is fundamentally different.
Cool.
Yep. To put all of this a different way.
Oh, I'm sorry. Could I do a quick, a quick correction here? Because the one that I played is actually called Cypher, Cyberpunk Text Adventure, and Cyberpunk 2077. It was a role playing system that CD Projekt Red is planning to make into a full game like Witcher 3. Did they make a text adventure of that too, or are we actually talking about Cypher? I'm curious.
We might be talking about Cypher.
So I think we're talking about Cypher because I couldn't find Cyberpunk 2077 as a pure text adventure.
That would explain why I thought it wasn't out yet.
Yeah, so it seems like we might actually be talking about Cypher, which is also a Cyberpunk game.
We are. You're totally right.
Okay. I'm sorry, I just wanted to make that correction in case people are listening.
Yes. Okay. Cyberpunk is apparently coming out in a couple of years.
Which I'm totally interested in. I'm sold on it completely. Very interested, but I just wanted to, for those who were responsible for making Cypher, just to give a shout. We'll include that when we post the podcast. And
future roundtable. There you go.
Yeah, it could be interesting. But yeah, so sorry, go ahead, Doc.
Well, one thing I wanted to say was, just to put all of this a different way, if you think back to the episode where we talked about the nonlinear models,
mm-hmm.
It's the one where we mentioned a cat. Basically, what we're talking about with Lifeline specifically is that is a multi-linear storyline,
mm-hmm.
which is not to be confused with a branching storyline. And interactive fiction, by definition, is typically a branching storyline. Now, it may or may not have foldbacks and bottlenecks and things like that. That's totally fine. But a lot of our video games move forward without ever folding back. And so somewhere existing between those different models is a fundamental design question that somebody's going to have to make whenever they write these things, which is, are all the pieces going to fit together eventually, or if you don't go down a certain path at a certain time, do you miss that content?
In other words, is
the world living and breathing without you? Is really what it comes down to.
Yes. And that sort of fundamental question is actually, you know, I haven't really done much games-related research recently, but one of sort of the core questions that I and some colleagues here have been asking ourselves is, have games really changed or evolved in the past 20 years? Because really, it's just graphical. If you compare the level,
I agree.
Yeah, if you compare the types of designs and interactions that occur over the past 10, 20 years of gaming, it's not fundamentally different. And so this notion of the game continuing without you, I immediately jumped to an example that I've brought up before on the show, Morrowind, or any of the Elder Scrolls games, really, some of the earlier ones,
sure.
where if you try to kill or disable or whatever some sort of NPC that is critical to the main story, you know, it says it pops up a text box that says, "Your actions have irrevocably changed the fate of the world, and now the game can't go on because you can't complete the story," or whatever.
Right.
And so,
which I've always thought was kind of a cop out. But.
It is, but it's a technical cop out, right? Because the technology and the hours, the man hours of development that would require or that would be required to make that a real option. I don't know if we could even do it today, really.
I think we could, but we need to think about a different engine entirely. The Lord of the Rings game that came out recently, Shadows of Mordor, the Nemesis system that was in that. You don't make it about a Nemesis, though. You make it about an NPC thing, where if one of the NPCs dies, another NPC steps up and takes his place.
I would go even farther than that, and you don't necessarily have to have this, oh, we need it to be this particular story with this particular character's background, etc., and you just make it more about the player's experience,
but forming their own story,
exactly.
But at what point are you?
I know.
Are you just creating another cop out though? Because so if the fundamental idea, the reason that they did that was, okay, you have killed this character that is the only one who has this fundamental knowledge about X quest, and so that now this quest is gone forever. You're done. If you just have another character generated by the system, it's still the same story, just with a little bit of different aesthetic flavoring because it's a different name giving you
that's
the quest.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, so, I know some of the earlier RPGs like Fallout, for example. Some of the ways they would get around this is that they would have like very few, if not like one or two, like NPCs that were actually these, you couldn't kill them. And whenever you would speak with them, it would be in a situation in which you wouldn't be able to kill them even if you tried. So otherwise, like for example, in Fallout 1, you go out into the world and you're trying to find, the gecko water chip or something.
Yeah.
And anything else that you do along the way is completely fair game. As you just have to find this chip at some point. You can find it in any way you choose. You just have to find the chip, and then when you return, like when you first are in there, you couldn't kill the, chief. I forgot his name, like the chief or the overseer. Yeah, the overseer in the vault. You couldn't kill him anyway. Nor would you want to. There's no reason. Nor are you even outfitted to do so.
It was kind of a jerk.
But when you come back, you have the opportunity to kill him. You can act in any way you want to. So it's a lot more open in the sense that the story doesn't really depend on one or two NPCs being alive. So, I mean, you can do it in that way. You can write the story in such a way that it doesn't matter if an NPC lives or, has to live.
So, I would draw the distinction that starting with Fallout, right, mm-hmm. is a game that tried to capture that sense of dynamic or sort of simulated procedural narrative by letting you act in whatever way you chose, and then when the game is completed, sort of gives you a projection of what all of your the consequences of all your choices, right?
Right.
And
it was limited. Well summarized, to be fair, it was limited for what it could do based on that technology.
And also, to be fair,
definitely.
It was
so then you jump,
extremely revolutionary for that.
It
game.
Was. Oh yeah.
It blew
Absolutely,
my mind
yeah.
when I played that.
Yeah, but so then we continue forward, and the Elder Scrolls games, they sort of give you a taste of that freedom in a 3D space, and then give you this sort of soft lockout by saying, okay, you can do this thing, and yeah, it's going to have the consequences that you think it would have. However, we're going to pop up this dialogue box that lets you know that, we haven't designed a failsafe in here for blah, blah, blah.
Which, I mean, always ruined it for me in the Elder Scrolls games.
That has been the limitation of interactive narrative. It has never advanced beyond that point in all of gaming. And then you jump over to procedural narrative, and the only advancement we've had over there has been Dwarf Fortress. So you have these sort of two dead ends that gaming just hasn't even explored. Since these times, we've only had updates in technology and updates in design that are reflective of aesthetic properties, which is why, you look and all of the processing power today is contained within GPUs. Like you could use a Pentium 4 to run some of these other games. Like all that you really care about is a graphics processor.
Oh, and we do. That's what's in your consoles.
Yeah.
That's exactly what's in your consoles.
I think that note is the fact that all we care about is graphical processing capability is sort of a call to our values in gaming.
I think it's sad. I think one of the things, and we've talked about this before, and I'm not going to go really deep into it because I've mentioned it specifically in other podcasts, but this idea that as we try to focus more and more on making a realistic experience and adding voice acting, it limits what you can do in story because you have to actually record all of these disparate choices with all of your voice actors. So, you know, as opposed to before, you could just write out all of these differences in text, which is hard enough as it is, but you also add in that extra production element of actually having voice actors voice every choice.
Instead of paying X $100,000 to hire voice actors for 800 hours of recorded audio, you spend that money to double your writing team.
Who knows?
I mean, because obviously we don't have the ability to procedurally generate a full interactive narrative. That's just not something that we figured out. Mm-hmm. But you can have such an enormous writing team that you could simulate it. You could fake it. And that's what all of these games recently have been doing. You know, The Walking Dead from Telltale and so on. They give the illusion of choice. And they do it very, very well. But that's why they do it in the episodic format. Mm-hmm. They do it in the 2 and 3 hour bites that are very bottlenecked, you know? Mm-hmm. So if you use a full-size 200-person game studio, you strip away the voice acting, you know, I think that you could really sort of work to reconceptualize narrative in games. Now, obviously, it's not doing so from a technical standpoint, like Dwarf Fortress, but, you know, there's advancements that can be made there, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, then let me interject just a devil's advocate kind of thing here. With that same episodic format that you're talking about, 5 has been standard. Since there is a significant time between Episode 1's release and Episode 5's release, and it gives the devs a chance to rewrite the story based on the choices that are being tracked, and they are being tracked, isn't that in and of itself a more... well, let's call it real way of having interactive fiction?
Interesting thought.
So the thing is, that's they say that's what they do.
Yeah,
but it's really not.
I agree. I think it's probably more
small tweaks to an overarching.
Yeah, story. I don't think they're changing it as much as they try to imply that they're changing it.
Gotcha.
So I would say that, Doc, what you're going after is absolutely true. It's just not what episodic games are doing. Mm-hmm. However, I think I also mentioned this in the last episode I was on, but there's an MMO in development, Revival, that basically tries to do just that. So the narrative of this MMO is sort of a Dungeons and Dragons style design where the development team has a bunch of game masters and writers that whenever they want to run an adventure module, it's a unique story that is reflective of the current state of the game and the player culture. They take over a bunch of NPCs, they spawn units, they lead players on sort of an adventure, players interact with them, and they shape the story as they go. It's basically a gaming-mediated adventure game.
Sounds like an alternate reality game to me, an ARG.
Essentially. Hmm. And so that is sort of what I think that you are alluding to is the potential within episodic gaming, but I don't think the episodic gaming developers are actually seizing upon that. Yeah. So having played the Game of Thrones Telltale games, there is very, very little reflexivity present from player feedback.
So a topic I'm interested to discuss as we start to wind things down a little bit here I'm looking at our list of points we're going to hit, and I think we've touched on most of them in one way or another. But one that I'm curious to talk about a bit is interactive fiction versus prose. Prose fiction, very linear, like pre-written, here's a novel that I have produced as an author.
It's what I call validity in some of my writing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what do we think are kind of the advantages of these interactive fiction games, especially the ones that are basically text-driven, where you make the occasional choice, versus a novel, do you think?
I'll go really fast on this one. It's the XY mechanic of narrative tension over time. You can control the narrative tension.
Hmm. Yeah.
You mean in an actual, in prose itself and not an interactive fiction?
Right. Well, you can do it in interactive fiction, but there's no guarantee. Really, right. What it comes down to is, you got to think about it this way, okay? Either you're going to make a choice that heightens the tension, or you're going to make a choice that lowers the tension, or else you're making no choice at all.
Right.
So if you are making a choice that's going to heighten the tension, and right now the tension is low, then that's probably a good narrative decision.
Mm-hmm.
So then we look at it and we go, that was what I was supposed to do. And so it really comes down to, can you write a story in such a way that there are multiple hooks and multiple paths where if you go left or you go right, there's unique enough difference to the left and the right so that both are really great stories. And not only that, but on the left and on the right, there's enough, call them more granular decisions, that it really becomes your story and still preserves the narrative tension, heightened and lowered, because that's what we really want. We want the, I think I know this and you fooled me, but not too much.
I mean, do you
what we really want.
Do you think, though, to give the advantage, the strength of the, just games themselves and interactive fiction, is that you have that increased player agency, and therefore any sort of tension that we do have is going to be increased because we feel like we're actually involved.
I think agency is overrated, honestly.
Really? Because I can tell you right now that I've read a lot of books, I've watched a lot of movies, and I enjoy them, and I can get very emotionally involved in the characters and their journey. But at the same time, I've never been more involved and felt more tension than I have playing a video game. Maybe that's not story related necessarily, sometimes it's not, but I feel the story and the journey of that character.
Clearly we need to stick a great big pin in that one and invite Richard back.
Yep. Yeah, we're kind of getting close on our time limit here, but I do think we've touched on a lot of great topics, and what I'm going to do now is, because Richard is our guest, I'm going to give him the closing thoughts. Richard?
Closing thoughts? Okay, well, if we're going to pin this later, I'd say that the difference in designed, pre-authored interactive fiction and sort of dynamic, player-driven, sort of agency-driven narrative is production value. So Doc talked about narrative tension, and while that's sort of an inherent factor in designing a narrative, that all sort of ties into the production value of a narrative. So if it's authored and ready for you to sort of interact with, then you're going to have these predefined moments that have been specially crafted for sort of effective involvement, effective with an A. And if you're doing things dynamically, live, etc., you have all of these what Tom Baker, a games writer, calls gamisms. So you look at something like The Last of Us. The Last of Us is a very powerful narrative about a father figure protecting the replacement of his dead daughter in this sort of post-apocalyptic landscape. Would make for an incredibly powerful book, movie, etc. And is also powerful in the sense that in a game you get to have this sort of agency to protect her yourself through your own actions. But is that worth the gamisms that come from this medium?
That's a great point. That's an excellent point. Yeah.
So you have these issues where Ellie, the girl character, she'll walk through enemies because the developers couldn't design around a better stealth system. And you have issues where you're the struggle for survival is contained within hitting X really fast to get out of a clicker's grip. And so you leave the theater of the mind and you enter into this sort of pigeonholed, ludic experience that causes you to lose some of your effective sort of involvement. And yeah, you get to have this sort of cheap interactive agency, but is it worth it?
Mm. Okay, that's a great point. I think that's not a topic of discussion to revisit for another podcast. Richard, I would really like to thank you for coming on and speaking with us. So I wish you a lot of luck over in Pennsylvania, and Anybody else want to say anything before we get ready to close this out?
Yeah, thanks, Rich, for hopping on. Definitely need to do it again soon.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely, guys. I'll be happy to.
Yeah, he definitely said his worth.
we got our money's worth.
Yeah. Wait, we're paying him?
Stop.
No, we aren't. And that's why it's worth it.
You scared me.
Richard's never coming back after all these puns.
You started it.
Oh, I thought I had escaped.
We've cut several. We cut several minutes of puns. The first like 10 minutes that we cut off the show was all puns, all Richard puns.
Yep. And we'd like to thank you, the audience, for joining us for episode number 50 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
And I'm Doc.
Oh, and I'm Richard.
We'll see you next time. Thanks.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, tell us about your favorite examples of interactive fiction and how you compare them to games and prose. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.
Backward compatible.